So here's a complete summary of the talk. For the competition, we won best student entry, also known as third place. Our submission is a single content model with no ensembling and runs in 2.7 seconds on a single GPU. After the submission, we further improved our performance with a model that trained longer and now uses left-right flipping at test time. Our submission depends on three key pieces. The bulk of our performance, the 5-point gain, comes from a new detector architecture, which we call IO. We got a 4-point gain from using better object proposals and using the entire train bell set. We got another 4-point gain by improving both the training and testing procedure. Everything is described in detail in a tech report published just a few days ago. Let's look at each piece in detail. The main ingredient is our new detector, which provides a 5-point gain, a relative boost of 25% over the old state-of-the-art fast RCNM. So just in case you weren't paying attention the last 10 times it was presented today and earlier this week, Fast RCNM works by pooling candidate regions out of a convolutional feature map and classifying them as containing either a particular category or background. It also predicts an adjustment to the box. So we can think of the first part as a feature extractor and the second part as a classifier. Recently in computer vision, the largest jumps in performance have consistently been from improving the feature extraction portion. With Fast RCNM, we can note two areas for improvement. First, small objects are not represented well in deeper feature maps and may get upsampled during ROI pooling. Second, only features inside the ROI are used for classification. We address the first limitation with skip connections and the second with recurrent neural networks. First, I'm going to present something that doesn't work and then show you how to fix it so it does. In a comp net, the different layers have different amount of resolution and different amounts of abstraction. As you move up the network, the resolution decreases and you get more abstract concepts. So earlier in the network, you can say where things are, but not what they are. And then later in the network, you can say what they are, but you don't know where they are. So we can get the best of both worlds by using skip connections to pool it at multiple layers at once, where the different coordinates of this, the ROI regions differ by the different amounts of scale. So we use the same ROI pooling mechanism on each layer. We can concatenate and pool blobs along the channel axis, and then we reduce the dimension, so that way the features have the correct shape for SD6. So this is our new feature extractor, and the classifier stays the same. Skip connections are an old idea and have been explored by many methods. Unfortunately, as presented here, this does not work. So the problem is that many different layers have very different amplitudes. SGG is not good enough to learn the right weights. The problem is too ill-conditioned. So Leo made this observation for semantic segmentation over the summer and suggested using L2 normalization so that way the feature maps have a common scale and then you can rescale them by a learned scale per channel. So we apply this insight to object detection. In our updated pipeline, we now separately L2 normalize each pooled feature by interpreting them as an unraveled vector. We can concatenate them and then rescale them back so that way we have the amplitude expected for SD6. So we measured the amplitude statistics on the training set and found that the mean input to FC6 has an amplitude of 1,000. So we initialize the rescaling to 1,000, and then we learn it during fine-tuning as a per-channel parameter. So without L2 normalization, performance severely drops as you start pooling for more layers, because the problem is too ill-conditioned to learn. It's really quite striking that as you add more and more connections and more data to your model, you start doing worse. However, once you add in L2 normalization and rescaling, performance is much better and significantly improves over the baseline. Since we find diminishing returns as we pool earlier in the network, we stop pooling at comp 3. So this is the convolution portion of the network based on VGG16, and here I'm showing it as a 3D representation. We pass an image through VGG16 and obtain a full convolutional feature map up to comp 5. Starting from comp 5, we add two more convolution layers, which we call comp 7. We place two RNNs on top of comp 5. They are four-directional, and I'll describe them shortly. The output is the same shape as comp 5. We also we call these context features because it summarizes the global context. We do all of this once per image and get a big stack of feature maps at varying resolution. We then pool out of 5 of these layers using ROI pooling as I described earlier. We can cap and scale them, reduce the dimension, and then classify them with fully connected layers. The top part happens once per image, and the bottom part happens once per ROI. So the top part will happen once, and the bottom part will happen 4,000 times in test time, for example. Now I'll tell you how the RNNs work. Let's look at the first few cells in COM5. We could feed these into a simple RNN to generate some output that describes the context to the left of each cell. We can do this for every row and compute it all in parallel. We call our RNNs lateral because they move across an image. So this is an idea that a number of people have been exploring at the same time. Here we're applying it to object detection to obtain context features. One issue that quickly becomes apparent is speed. RNNs are super slow because of the dependency between cells, especially if you use existing code bases that typically compute RNNs with a single GPU call for every cell for every single step. So some re-engineering is needed. So to make implementation easier, we transpose all of the directions to left to right and then write a single optimized GPU implementation that can step column-wise at a time. So all of the indexing ugliness is now combined with an 8-line GPU kernel that does the transpose. The transpose is a little bit slow because you have a non-uniform memory access, but I don't think there's any way around it. Here we show the RNN equation for one cell, emitting biases for simplicity. Notice that we're using an RNN, a simple RNN with ReLU. Liu et al. Recently showed that ReLU RNNs can be optimized if you initialize a recurrent transition to the identity. They call these things iRNNs. They're much simpler and faster to compute than LSTMs or GUUs. If you wanted to implement this over an image, the transitions into and out of the hidden state can be thought of as one-by-one convolutions. You can now see that these are three pieces with separate layers, an input to hidden convolution, the recurrent transitions, which is the equation on top, and the hidden to output. The different directions are independent and join up at the end with a concatenation. So each direction summarizes the context along a different direction. But once you write it this way, it becomes clear that you can play around with it, you can swap things around, and you can start sharing things. So for example, first we swap the output and the concatenation. So now you have a smaller output, and this also mixes together the different directions. You can also share the input to hidden transition. Instead of computing four separate input to hidden layers, we compute it once and then copy it four times for the different directions. So sharing the convolutions in this way allows us to save on three whole convolutions and in fact has almost no change in accuracy for this task. So then we stack two of these together and use the output features in the detector. Because we have two of these four-directional RNNs, the output is fully global. So that means that every value in the output depends on every value in the input, but it's also spatially varying. So each cell in the output is a summary of what is happening from the point of view of that cell location. We can also regularize these features with semantic segmentation. It's an extra task that's not used at test time. It's just to give some extra bits of training information, and it gives about 1 point of improvement. You can look at the details in the semantic segmentation portion in our tech report. So just to show the spatial dependence a little bit more clearly, here's an illustration of what happens when you consider a single cell in the input and what is its output dependency. After a single four-directional RNN, the information is smeared directly up, down, left, and right. And after the second RNN, information is propagated everywhere. So it's global, but spatially varying. So that's the whole ION model. This model, with everything else held the same, gives 5 points of improvement on the test dev set over fast RCNN. In summary, we added skip connections with L2 normalization for better features inside the ROI, and added stacked four-directional RNNs for context outside the RNN. Most of the benefit comes from looking better inside the ROI. So hopefully you're here just earlier for Jitendra's talk, where he said context is worth about 1 to 2 percentage points. Yes, indeed, on VOC 2007, we get 2 points for adding context. So that was the first ingredient. The second ingredient is improving box proposals and using more training data, i.e. including the validation set and training time. COCO contains some pretty crazy objects, and it requires new box proposal methods to properly include them all. So assuming you were all in Montreal last week at NIFS, you would know that RPN is a new box proposal method. It uses the ComNet to produce proposals, and it uses reference boxes called anchors, and proposals are predicted relative to the anchors. So RPN works okay for COCO, but it works much better if you add more anchors. The original method predicts 9 anchors for location, but for COCO, we found significant gains if you predict many more scales and aspect ratios, so you have 22 anchors per location. Despite the fact that MCG, a competitor method, has a much higher average recall in RPM, it in fact performs about the same once you combine it with the detector. Average recall is only loosely correlated to the final detector performance. Or in other words, it doesn't matter if you're able to find more objects at the box proposal step if you can't later on classify them with your detector. We get even better results if you mix together the two. We find that they have sort of a complementary form of errors. So 1,000 of each is better than 2,000 of a single box proposal method. And the third and last ingredient is that we have improved the training parameters and testing procedure, and it gives us an extra 4 points. So to improve over faster SNN, we remove dropout, which makes the model converge faster and perform better at test time. This suggests that, in fact, all along we're using too small of a model, and perhaps we should be using bigger nets in the future. We train for longer and with larger mini-batches, and we regularize the semantic segmentation predictions. This gives us a few points compared to the baseline. At test time, we use the iterative method just presented by Guidaris and Komanakis this week as ICCB. Their method works in several steps. First, you follow the standard procedure for detecting objects. You process the box proposals, you classify them, and you address them to improve positions. Now you have a new set of boxes. You can feed those back into the network and iteratively address them a second time. Then you merge them all together in a big bag of boxes, and then you apply non-max suppression and weighted voting. So this works really well in Pascal. For our detector, it gave us a 2-point boost, but unfortunately it reduces performance as is on COCO because you're now blurring together boxes and precise localization is super important for the new COCO measure. However, if you play around with the thresholds and solve for a new optimal set of thresholds, then you can fix this issue. We also add left-right flips at test time and average the results together. So all of these tricks together give us another 2 points. Finally, we'd like to point out that we believe our method is potentially complementary to the winning entry. They got a 6-point gain from making the network significantly deeper, but they may possibly see a further gain from incorporating our ION architecture. We plan to release the code for our method. Thanks for listening.
We'll take a few questions for the speaker, if you have any.
Thank the speaker again.